standards. On 11th August 1921, while addressing women compatriots, he wrote, quote, "Let me confess to you that your spontaneous and loving response all over India has convinced me that God is with us," end of quote. It is this humane appeal of his philosophy that makes Gandhi universal and helps him transcend time. He was not a great orator, mostly given to homilies on high moral values with only flashes of occasional humor, and yet if he continues to inspire contemporary leaders of the stature of Nelson Mandela or Aung San Suu Kyi, as the chairman referred to, it is emeritus chairman, by the way, it is because of its relevance in today's world of anger and intolerance. As Aung San Suu Kyi began her long struggle to end the 5 decades of military rule in Myanmar, she openly acknowledged her personal admiration for Gandhi, who, she remarked, had reconciled tradition and modernity in a manner she found most appealing. She wrote, "In spite of his deeply ingrained Hinduism, Gandhi's intellectual flexibility made him accept those elements of Western thought which fitted into the ethical and social scheme he considered desirable." At a press conference when Barack Obama, the current president of the USA, was asked to name one person, dead or alive, with whom he would like to share a meal, he mentioned Gandhi. Though he said it would be a very small meal. But Gandhi just drank a little and drank goat's milk, that's about all. And said that if it was not for Gandhi, the civil rights movements in the US led by Martin Luther King would not have had its unique non-violent character. Some time back, I was surprised to note that Apple, that icon of techie, savvy youthfulness, had used Gandhi as an advertising model. The poster board had him sitting with folded legs in his customary, humble Indian attire and said, "Think different." That is the magic of Gandhi. He is historical, apolitical, a cult figure that comes to mind whenever there is need to fight injustice or spread change. Let me now come from the sublime to the ordinary. And let me end with two examples of Gandhiji's teachings on present-day social activism. First, the story of Krishna Bal. '84 years old. And her husband, Jagannathan, 92, of Chennai. They're still active, very much so, and this is their latest publication, which I will help to pass on. Now, what did they do? Inspired by Gandhi's emphasis on self-reliance, they joined Vinoba Bhave's Budan movement, a non-violent social transformation of rural India. Through their efforts, about 4 million acres of land was obtained as donations across several states in India and distributed to thousands of landless poor. Paying heed to Gandhi's message that constructive work is the main hope of India, the couple launched several initiatives to uplift the lot of women and their mothers. Yes, it's truly an inspiring story of love and sacrifice. And though they met when they were 24, they refused to get married until India became independent. Now, their son, Dr. Bhumi Kumar, follows in their footsteps and brings succor to the children of Cambodia through various programs run by Caritas, the French-inspired humanitarian organization. I would request my friend to post this magazine on the internet so that all of us can share. There are many, many more things that this couple are doing, and it's inspiring how Gandhiji's teachings are still there. Now, on a lighter note, let me tell you about Gandhi Bhim. This is a way of dealing with people and making them realize their mistakes through gentle persuasion. In the town of Srinagar, Kashmir, traffic offenders are given a glass of water by the police and educated about their mistakes. They are told about the risks to their own lives and those of others due to their errors. According to an article in Tabla, which is a newspaper printed in Singapore, the headline is "Kashmir Turns to Gandhi." Now, Gandhigiri is a term, relatively recent term, that owes its origin to a Bollywood musical comedy of 2006 titled "Lago Rago Munamai." Now, this is an excellent movie you should watch, in which the ideals of non-violent persuasion advocated by Mahatma Gandhi were put into practice to address various problems faced by Indians in present-day society and others. Perhaps this is a practice that the traffic police in our cities can emulate to address the mounting problems that we all face. As for my friend who made me set sail on this voyage of discovery, I can only tell him that, like the messages given by our saints and sages throughout the ages, Gandhi's teachings are eternal and will stand the test of time. It is up to us and to succeeding generations to remain true to them and put them into practice as best as we can. I would like to congratulate the Gandhi Memorial Trust for dedicating itself to this noble cause. And all of us, in our own way. But this should not be an once-a-year event. I think all of us, in our own ways, can help to show that the messages that Gandhi had left behind can be put into use in our daily lives, as I showed by the two examples. Thank you very much.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, now that we have heard all the disclosures by our speaker, we would like to hear more inspiration from our next. Our next speaker is Dato Dr. Anwar Faizal. If Thomas More is to be referred to as the man for all seasons, then our next speaker must be hailed as a man for all civilized society. His CV contained in the program contains so much information that it takes time to ascertain what Dato Dr. Anwar did, was involved in, and is involved in, and who he really is. In my view, it can be best summarized from these borrowed words, and I quote, "He is an international civil society person with particular focus on consumer issues, breastfeeding, environment, and sustainable development. On consumer issues, he was committed to broaden the consumer's concern beyond the weights and measures, food adulteration, and product. As president of the Consumers International from 1978 to 1984, he assured that the voice of the poor consumers in developing world was heard internationally. On the environmental front, as chairman of the Wetland International Asia Pacific based in Malaysia, he assures that our rivers, our lakes, our coastal waters are protected. Associated with this, he was in the forefront to promote Malaysia as a place for cultural peace with the environment. Dr. Anwar was born in Perak in 1941, but subsequently educated in Penang. As a Penang Free School alumni, with distinction in both sports and studies, he obtained school blues in four sports: rugby, cricket, hockey, and athletics. He then went on to the University of Malaya and graduated with honors in economics and education. He proceeded to join the teaching profession and then the civil service. Currently, he is the director of the Right to Livelihood College in the University of Science, and this allows him to continue to promote global peace, ecological sustainability, and social justice. I now present you our next speaker.
In the tradition of Mahatma Gandhi, his universality and his humility and his humanity, let me begin by saying, brothers and sisters, children of Mother Earth, citizens of the universe, Assalamu alaikum, may peace be on you. We live today in a world where there are too many people who are not at peace with themselves, who are not at peace with others, and who are not at peace with Mother Earth. As we in Malaysia have a penchant for setting up royal commissions, I thought we might set up one to remember the work of Mahatma Gandhi and the directions for the future. Of course, our royal commissions have an intriguing and sometimes frustrating record of implementation. And perhaps, there should be an annual progress report on every royal commission that has been set up since we became independent. And this annual report should be made public so that we, the people, have a deep look also into the issues and how they are being dealt with. No royal commission would be forgotten. And not only would the people take the word royal, seriously, and in a constitutional democracy, of course, or vice versa, too, because the people want to be also taken seriously. So on Gandhiji's birthday, I thought we could begin, and he might appreciate the notion of a intergalactic commission on the state of Mother Earth. What's wrong and what can be done? Let me attempt to speculate what this intergalactic commission would say. Sadly, our rating, I think they call it the KPI, key performance indicators nowadays, for planethood management would probably be between poor and dismal. The report will begin, probably, with a dramatic revelation that on this planet, one person commits suicide every 40 seconds. One person is murdered every 60 seconds. One person is killed in war every 100 seconds. And most of those who are killed in war are no longer soldiers. They're very well protected. It's largely civilians, and many of them women and children. There are 1 billion people who are hungry and suffering from malnutrition, and there are 1 billion people now who are obese and overweight. And soon, there will be 1 billion senior citizens. A number of us, of course, have already graduated to that category. So this commission, this intergalactic commission, will be really finding a society that's wracked with violence and inequity. They will find an environment which they would say, my God, you guys are committing ecocide. We are beginning to work in ways in the environment which are self-destructing. They will find an economic system that is stimulated by a kind of casino thinking. Not real economics, speculation, casinos, pornography, military hardware, puerile entertainment, with the gross criminal product. There's an official term, maybe you can ask the United Nations here. They've got gross national product, gross domestic product. There's also a gross domestic product. It's actually one of those that's increasing very rapidly. But not many countries would like to disclose that particular statistic. These people who are part of this growth of the gross criminal product are leading the pack. Criminal and corrupt practices, very often in the form of financial institutions. Sadly. The commission also would look around and find that the father of all failures, is a failure of governance. A governance, unfortunately, that are run by players in the world today who are stimulated and who are motivated by greed and hypocrisy, grand greed and grand hypocrisy of bigotry and racism and a lust for power. They will find that the real axis of evil is violence, is manipulation, it's waste. They will condemn the preponderance not only of weapons of mass destruction. It's amazing, only a fraction of the cost that we are spending on those weapons and those mass destruction can actually solve all the education, health, and other problems in the world. Just a fraction of that. But no, this earth is moving towards the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, but also weapons of mass deception. Weapons of mass deception, lies and propaganda, which are used as ways to manipulate not only economics, but also manipulate voice. And weapons of mass consumption, where products, now you get yourself addicted to products, and one can talk about tobacco, junk foods, and alcohol, oil also. So this Galactic Commission will say, well, what can we do? What must be done? The first thing that this Galactic Commission will say, please remember what Mahatma Gandhi said. He talked about the social sins. I call them the sins against humanity. And our MC mentioned some of them, and I'll just repeat them because I think they need to be ingrained. Politics without principles, wealth without work, and that talks about crony and rentier type of capitalism, enjoyment without conscience, knowledge without character, business without morality, science without humanity, religion without compassion. And these were the seven. I think if Mahatma Gandhi, they said, was alive today, he would add four more to those seven. He would add rights without responsibilities. And not only rights without responsibilities, but the importance of a third R, relationships. Because in the world today, if you may talk about rights, you will talk, but if we don't have a sense of community, if we don't have a sense of relationship, we don't listen to each other, this wonderful word listen, which in Chinese is ting. Ting, and we take the old characters, it's made out of an ear, an eye, and the heart. Isn't that amazing that a word called listen has these three dimensions? There's such a powerful, and it is that kind of listening that comes from the heart that is so essential. So rights and responsibilities with nurturing of relationships of caring and sharing. Power without accountability. Power without accountability, where in fact governments very often globally can do things with impunity, disregarding ethics, disregarding responsibilities. And then development without sustainability. Development without sustainability, which His Excellency, our representative in the UN, talked a great deal, is one of the central concerns in the UN at the moment. And the 11th, extremely important, is laws without justice. Laws without justice. So these four are extremely important. Now it is, and they say, remember Mahatma Gandhi, but tell me who, they said, think who said these words. Every gun that is made, every warship that is launched, every rocket that is fired signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger, those who are not fed, and those who are cold and not clothed. Who said in most communities it is illegal to cry fire in a crowded assembly? Should it not be considered serious international misconduct to manufacture a general war scare in an effort to achieve local political aims? Who said in the councils of government we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex? Military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. Who said, together we must learn how to compose differences, not with arms, but with intellect and with decent purpose? Who said this? The Intergalactic Commission said. These words were said by General Eisenhower, who was commanding the European forces in the Second World War in Europe, and who later became the President of the United States. Someone who knew war. But when he became President, he understood exactly what was going on in this world. And the idea of the military-industrial complex was in his final speech when he retired as president, and he wanted to remind everybody that there are forces that run the world in a way in which that is not in the public interest. So this Intergalactic Commission says, remember, these are people, not only peacemakers like Gandhi, but people who have gone through war, who have led war, who have killed, have said that that is not the way. Then, what would Commission says, what can we do? What can we do? They say, look for people and look for initiatives that are getting things done. That are getting things done. The world is full of PhDs, the intellectuals. The world needs more people with BST, blood, sweat and tears people, huh? People with passion who are prepared to seek and fight for the kinds of values that Mahatma Gandhi was talking about. And third, the GTDs, yeah? Those people who are very good at getting things done. Yeah? Because sometimes the brightest, intelligent people, the most passionate, cannot move unless they link up with the third group, the third kind of skill. So the commission says, you know, look around. There are people in this country, in this Mother Earth, in this Mother Earth official, and Mother Earth, by the way, is now official United Nations language. Eh? Mother Earth, no? There is a Mother Earth Day now, no? Officially by the General Assembly. One time we said this Mother Earth, you know, but now it's UN language. See? Look at people, don't worry about optimists and pessimists. Talk about the possibilists, the people who get things done, who move, who look around and say, there's a problem, what can I do? How can we get organized? How can we move? And they mentioned 12 initiatives that they were most impressed with, that they feel people should share and learn and appreciate. One is the Charter of Compassion. Treat others like you want to be treated. That's by Karen Armstrong. It's a global movement and is celebrated every year. It was launched here by the former Prime Minister, and there's a network of people. All these you can pick up later, a sheet which gives you also the websites. Yeah? So you don't have to write them down. If you don't pick up one later, you can always ask me. So the first, this great idea of a Charter of Compassion, because if you want a single golden rule from all the spiritual traditions, just think always, is this the way that I would treat, like to be treated? Yeah, this is a very powerful idea, and I think this idea should proliferate. Those of us who've been working on interfaith issues have taken this as our central work. The second is another great activity called the Global Epic, and this was by the Parliament of World Religions. And this is a remarkable thing, which was by someone called Hans Kung, and now it's continued in different forms with different kinds of people. You have the Cordoba Initiative, you have this Alliance of Civilizations with Venezuela and Iran, amazingly two countries that very often are picked as terrible people who are actually leading this, but their own work was frustrated by governments who did not like the way that they operate. Sometimes the very governments who have destroyed democracy in their own countries through organizing revolutions because they did not like those people who are up there. And one leader of one of those countries once said, you know, he's a son of a bitch. We don't care as long as he's our son of a bitch. Yeah? So it's not about democracy, about values. It's about power and whom you control. And there was no compunction in destroying democracy in order to get control. And that was the way in which... So this Global Ethic, which is quite... remarkable. You can pick up the Charter of Compassion and the Golden Rule from all the religions as you leave. Hans Kung once said, no peace among the nations without peace among the religions. No peace among the religions without dialogue between the religions. No dialogue between the religions without global ethical standards. No survival of our globe without a global ethic. You can also pick this up later. It's got a The words coexist, made from the symbols of the different religions of the world. And they move on from the global ethic to a third. And this is interesting, and Gandhi will have been most impressed. It's called the Simplicity Institute. And it's got huge manuals and all kinds of ways by which you can begin to transform your life into ways which you do things extremely simplistically. Just go to their website and you will find their even take on how to do peace drawing from Gandhi's work. And they organize workshops and sessions in which younger people can grow into doing things the way in which we are. Because very often, great ideas are there, but they are not translated and not made into little modules that people can connect with and use. And this Simplicity Institute is an amazing movement. It's based in down under in Australia, and it's becoming viral. It's about education for simple living, which was one of the core values of Mahatma Gandhi. And the fourth, the slow food movement. It's against the fast food movement. It began with people who were wanting to build a fast food place right in the center of Rome, and this person organized a campaign to stop this monstrosity of a global fast food chain building right in the center of this historic place. They fought and they won. And then they decided the world must begin to connect back with food and enjoy it and go local, just food, thinking in terms of how the processes that were doing, how to make it healthy. And now they have a university of gastronomy, and there are 130 countries where there are slow food circles. They have conferences every year, amazing, amazing groups. There's actually a small group in Kuala Lumpur, there's a group also in Penang. In Penang, the next particular session is a product that they're going to do at the World Conference on Slow Food next month is on laksa. You know, the group comes and they talk about laksa, they talk about the ingredients, they have a tour that they take foreign tourists, and you go and buy all the ingredients, and you talk about the ingredients, and then you prepare them, and you enjoy food in a totally different way because you're connected with all the different elements. They had earlier a lecture on coconut. This is the history of the coconut. If there was a Nobel Prize for trees, then the coconut would get it. Yeah? You know, because it's just amazing if you understand, but we have become disconnected with those kind of things. We just get milk in a plastic thing and then we just go. We're disconnected. And this slow food movement gets you to connect with everything that we are, because as you know, many civilizations go, you are the food you eat. And if you are not connected in the right way with it, you are finished, you're just going to be junk. Yeah? The fifth, they say, the Earth Charter. This was a citizens movement, right, that they have an enormous, you can also pick this up if you like, yeah? The Earth Charter is the headquarters in Costa Rica, and it is one of the best statements on what the Earth, what the world should be like. Again, Gandhi would be interested. They have hundreds of things you can do to make the Earth a better place. There's also now a declaration on the rights of Mother Earth. At one time we used to talk about human rights. So right. Now, the rights of Mother Earth, and the government of Ecuador has already adopted it. They are moving it into the United Nations, and I think there will be discussions on how that kind of instrument of human rights can also be applied to the rights of other living things, including those of nature. So go to this charter, and now as I mentioned, the United Nations has taken this as a international day. Sixth, the Yes magazine. Oh, it's interesting, all the time we're talking no. But here is a group that runs a journal for positive futures. And that's one of the things that Gandhi said. I mean, if we are always there, depressed, negative, yeah, we're not going to move. That's the best thing that the enemy needs, for you to be depressed and to be pessimistic. If you say yes, what can we do? We move. And this journal itself is amazing. Yeah? And you can just go down and look at the posters that they have, the way they write their journals, all the good things that are happening, because the power of success is so, so inspiring. Because when someone comes and tell you, hey, it cannot be done, this is stupid, get out of the way, people are already doing it. Because you have inspiring stories that we need. Then the seventh, the happiness movement. One would think, well, happiness is just, you know, like that. Now, it's become a powerful tool. This from 72, when the Bhutan government, the ruler of Bhutan, began this particular process. And this year, the United Nations produced a report, a world happiness report, systematically making out that. So the whole transformational thinking of what is important in life and what is important in terms of the future is being transformed. The vocabulary is now quite different in place. And this particular movement is going to go, every country now is going to start having to write a happiness report, which will be quite a different thing from just the pure economics kind of thinking. And you can go, we have an international society for ecology and culture. There's a wonderful movie called The Economics of Happiness that has won several awards. I think it won the award in the Sundance Festival, which is one of the really remarkable festivals of alternative thinking. The seventh is the happiness. The eighth is the culture of peace. UNESCO had one decade promoting the culture of peace. Huh? They had 6 criteria, they had 99 ways, simple ways by which you can actually produce. And we are very fortunate in Malaysia that we actually have systematically this peace initiative being done in the town of Taiping, where I grew up, and Taiping means everlasting peace. Yeah? It's a town named Peace. And we have a booklet of all the 99 ways you can do peace. Very simple, simple things you can do. It's available in Chinese, Tamil, Bahasa, and all the words in peace in all the major languages of the world. You can pick up some of these also outside. There's a whole movement for peace education that is going. This is what we need even more. This kind of 99 ways should be standard teaching in our schools. Every day you should do some things like this. It's also like the act of kindness movement. A lot of people are not aware that there's an act of kindness movement where you can do little things of kindness. Like in this one, is just learn how to smile, you know? Try and keep the smile. Otherwise, we have to have a factory that actually sells like these headphones, but one that, you know, you put on your ear here, it can also act as an earphone and your IP and everything else, you know, MPP, is it like, or MP player. But at the same time, it makes you smile. Unfortunately, it's becoming like that, where people have even forgotten it. Now instead, we have laughter clubs, where people who are saying simple things like laughing and enjoying, we have already lost. It's so difficult, it requires you to go for a workshop before you learn how to smile and laugh. Right? So the culture. And then Gandhi will also be so happy that there is a huge community of people in the United States, and they follow. They call them the 17 rules of a sustainable community. Yeah? 17, by which you can systematically be local, be just, be enjoyable, and whole communities go up in a total self-reliant way, and for those things that they need, that they connect with other communities that they want. And this is Wendell Berry's 17 rules. It's the amazing, amazing story, and it's the kind of thing that Gandhi was promoting, that we have to become local, connected, and yet at the same time also universal and global. But don't distort the whole system. Begin from the roots and begin from where you are. And there's a thing called the Right Livelihood Award. 150 odd people, two of them were mentioned earlier, of Gandhians in India. These are 150 people and institutions that have been given the Alternative Nobel Prize. And this Alternative Nobel Prize, unlike the other prize which is given chemistry, physics, you know, it's just very silo research and that kind, plus one piece which is very political. This is actually given for people who are change makers in society. You know, the kind that Gandhi was. If he was there, he would have been the recipient of this particular award, because he was a change maker of the community. And these people come from 17 or 18 domains, from human rights, from environment, a whole range of them. And every year we give 4 of these awards. And this year, it will interest you that one of the winners of the award was Samir Amin from Afghanistan. This is the woman who was a minister for human rights. She's been an amazing person who's been looking at women's issues in a very difficult situation. Another person was Dr. Gene Sharp. He's nearly 90, and he wrote the classic book on the politics of nonviolence. And over these last, you can say, 30 years, where there's been transformation in many countries and civil, you know, say revolutions, his book was the textbook of this. And he has 198 non-violent tactics that people can use. With each tactic, he has given the total history, the total history of that particular tactic. Okay? And if you are also interested, we have reproduced in Malaysia, it's called The Weapons of Mass Transformation. 198 non-violent techniques to make the world a better place for all. Yeah? You can download this from the website. And what is interesting also is tactic 57. Tactic 57 is the lysistratic action. Lysistratic action. When this was translated into Hindi for the World Social Forum that was held in Bombay a decade ago, I have sent this and we printed 10,000 copies. They could not translate that word. Yeah? And they found out that it is from Greek. And it is the non-violent technique that was used by women to say, hey, stop all these wars. What are we doing? What are we producing children for them to get killed in war? So the women got together and said, no more sex. Finish. Until you stop the war. Yeah. And this was an act. And it's occurring now. Yeah. In Africa and three places in the world now, women are getting together and say, no, no to war. Yeah. And if you don't, forget it. Yeah? Forget it. You know, what's the point of bringing children? And there's a group in England who campaign against arms trade, because the arms trade is an amazing, Eisenhower talked about the military industrial complex, and the way in which the most corrupt arrangements very often are done. Like in Britain particularly, the fact that such corruption had occurred was even blocked by the government, because they say for security reasons. We cannot expose the corruption that is occurred. I mean, for security reasons, you cannot. You know, which is the bigger value? Yeah, for that. Yeah, and the 11th is something very remarkable that comes to us from the United Nations. See, every single social movement that Gandhi was involved in, every single social movement where people of the world have been involved with, always through civil society activity, culminates in the United Nations. And out of the United Nations then there comes finally a decision that it becomes universally accepted. I mean, Gandhi once made it, at the beginning they reject you, you know, but in the end it becomes acceptable. So just like Mahatma Gandhi's life, October the 2nd became the non-violent day. So there are over 100 days, weeks, decades that actually take up every single one of the issues. And that's the culmination of the success that civil society has. And those days very often, unfortunately, are ignored. Just like the way we celebrate every one of these, International Women's Day, Child Day, Environment Day, you mentioned Palestine Day, the whole range of days. Every single one of them must become a central activity for every school. If you want to have a calendar, the calendar should not be about public holidays. Calendar should be on the days of action. And if you go to the website, and this again you can pick up if you like, right at your college, we do taking action, links to make it happen, days, weeks, decades, and you can get all that. Otherwise, you just go to a website called un.org observances. Yeah? And it's an amazing, amazing resource. And the last resource, the 12th resource, it's a website, because now the way forward is very often the new technologies. You want instant information, you want instant link. And this is a very simple website, started by one person in his home. And it's the world's best website. It's called Better World Links. Very simple. Better World Links, to be well informed and connected with every single civil society organization that is working on any issue. You can go there and just type in the issue, you'll get materials, you'll get connections, you'll get that. So this Intergalactic Commission will say, hey, people of the world are doing things. There are remarkable stories that are there. Join them and work with them. And if you do, then you will find that particular change. I'd like to end with a short poem that I wrote some years ago for a book called Prayers for the Next Millennium. And it says, Gandhi would resonate with this: we all drink from one water, we breathe from one air, we rise from one ocean, and we live under one sky. Remember, we are one. The newborn baby cries the same everywhere. The laughter of children is universal. Everyone's blood is red. And our hearts beat the same song. Remember, we are one. We are all brothers and sisters, only one family, only one birth. Remember, we are one. Peace be on you, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum and thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, once again, a big hand for the two wonderful, entertaining lectures. Lots of humor. I think that was just to soften the whole truths and the hard truths and the questions that you now have to deal with. You talk of peace, or what have you done to have peace within yourself? You laugh, you hear, but will you listen? Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to invite Mr. Radha. I was trying to think, Mr. Radha, everybody's called you an unofficial ambassador. What would be the honorific for an unofficial ambassador? And I decided that it's friend. So I'd like our friend, Mr. Radha, to come up and do the honors and present our speakers with a token of appreciation. Let's begin with Ambassador. All right, Mr. Radha, if you present a token of appreciation to Ambassador Kesavapanu. Also to Dr. Anwar. And not forgetting Tantri James Full, who had some wonderful introductions for us. Photograph time. Thank you, gentlemen. May I invite you to take your seats so that we can move to the next item on our program. Ladies and gentlemen, the recipient of the Public Service Award is Montfort Boys Town. I'd now like to call upon Mr. A. Navamohinder, Secretary of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, to read the citation. Mr. Navam.
The Board of Trustees of the Gandhi Memorial Trust has great pleasure in presenting the Public Service Award this year to Montfort Boys Town in recognition of its distinguished record for public service. Montfort Boys Town was established in October 1st, 1959, at an abandoned rubber estate at Batutiha, Selangor, as a charitable organization by the Brothers of St. Gabriel. Montfort Boys Town provides the much needed food and shelter to underprivileged youth who are orphans, who are from poor families, broken homes, single parent families, and indigenous families. It recognizes that these youth need much more than just food and shelter to transform them into responsible young adult and tomorrow's nation builders for Malaysia. The pioneering brothers were Brother Ravish, Brother Evariste, Brother Fernand, and Brother Henry. They dreamed to inflame hope and prepare the disadvantaged youth for a bright future. So they conceptualized the residential cum vocational skills training program. The dream was made a reality not only by their goodwill, but by the goodwill of many caring corporate sponsors, donors, and benefactors. Today, the brothers still passionately strive to carry out its decisive mission of providing care and development for the disadvantaged youth. Its main administrative affairs are governed by the Provincial Council and the Board of Governors, while for its daily operational affairs, it is managed by the Management Committee. As an institution of public character, it reports to the Minister of Finance, Ministry of Finance, and Ministry of Welfare. As an accredited skills training institution, it is affiliated with the Ministry of Human Resources. The GMT is therefore happy to present the Public Service Award to the Montfort Boys Town in recognition of its 53 years of tireless efforts of pursuing a mission of holistically educating academically and economically challenged youth.
Thank you, Mr. Nanda. Mr. Nanda, could we have you up once again to do the honors? I'd also like to invite Yamabagya Dan Sridhar Clifford Herbert, Chairman, Board of Governors, Mumford Boys Town, also Brother John Albert, Director, to come up and receive the award on behalf of the Mumford Boys Town.
Dear friends of peace, peace be upon you. On behalf of the Brothers of St. Gabriel, on this gracious day, we thank you from the bottom of our heart for your presence and also for recognizing these 53 years of hard work. It takes bricks to make house, but it takes heart to build people. And over these 53 years, Montfort's lifeline is the public, the corporate sponsors, individual donors. Each of your giving has given hope to these young people. In a while, they will sing a song to you, "You Raised Me Up." Thank you and God bless all of you.
Boys Town would like to share this moment with some of the donors and the board of governors who are here. Maybe invite them for a quick photograph. The board of governors, yes. Welcome. Thank you very much. Congratulations. And also, happy belated birthday to Montfort Boys Town, 1st of October. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for a very special performance from Montfort Boys Town. Here they are with "You Raise Me Up."
Raise me up. Thank you, Monfort Boystown. That was lovely. Honoured guests, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to a close of today's event. Thank you so much for being here, for sharing this moment with us. We are serving a vegetarian tea, so please do join us for refreshments. We'd like to wish you to go in peace, and if you ever feel disheartened, perhaps you should remember the words of the Mahatma who had this to say: you must not lose hope in humanity. You must not lose faith in humanity. Humanity is an ocean. If a few drops of the ocean are dirty, that ocean does not become dirty. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Yeah, I got it.